Good afternoon, students. Today we'll look at lecture two. Last week we did lecture one, where we look at the private commodity market. Today we'll look at the monopolistic market. I believe most of you know my name. My name is Adolfo Salimona James, and I'm taking ECN 302, Intermediate Microeconomics. Without much ado, let's start with the main business of the day. Now, under monopoly, we look at the definition, the causes, the equilibrium condition, price discrimination, and then conclusion. Let's start by defining monopoly. A monopoly is a market where we have just a single seller of a commodity without a closed-end substitute. In a monopolistic market, we are saying that there's only one seller of a commodity without a rival, that's without a closed end substitute. Now, we are looking at it from the real life point of view. Monopoly actually exists in most economies. In fact, any industry that says that has only one firm that dominates the market, the only seller of a commodity, that kind of firm could be called a monopoly. Now, looking at the causes of monopoly, we have basically three causes of monopoly. We have the legal monopoly, the natural monopoly, and the one caused by economic of scale. Now let me start from the first one, the legal monopoly. When we say a firm is a legal monopoly, we are saying that by law, that firm is the only producer of that particular commodity by law. That means the firm does not have any close substitute. It could be maybe due to patent rights, that the exclusive rights given to a producer to sell its product for some years. With patent rights, or maybe government regulation, or government intervention, or government policy, state laws, and the rest, so on and so forth. But legal monopoly has to do with state power, state control. For instance, the government could want to own a particular resource. It could be maybe the petroleum industry, which is very important, very key to the Nigerian economy. They could create a barrier of entry and exit, whereby there will be a monopoly controlling that particular market. Also, the second one I mentioned was a natural monopoly. Now, the natural monopoly is an opportunist, so to say. A monopolist that maybe due to its strategic location, it controls some basic natural resources, and because of that, it becomes a monopoly. It could be maybe cement. Perhaps maybe a firm is located to a cement that is a limestone company, because the limestone is a major input for cement. Now, if a firm is located to a limestone industry, it could be a monopoly that is controlling the resources and then be the only producer of cement. So the next one is the monopoly by economic of scale. Now, by economic of scale, we are looking at maybe due to increase in production and decrease in cost. If that could be a monopoly, maybe because of its managerial ability, skills, and even sometimes markets are not big enough to actually accommodate two firms. And in this situation, the firm could be a monopoly because the market is not actually big enough to accommodate two firms. Now, the next thing we look at is the equilibrium condition under the monopolistic markets. The equilibrium condition under the monopolistic markets. Now, unlike private competition, our lecture one's topic, for monopoly, profit is actually allowed. You know, in private competition, we have three cases in the short run. We have the losses, we have the break-even, and we have the profit. But for the long run, they make only profit. On the other hand, for private competition, they make only break-even. That is in the normal profit or the break-even. But for the monopolist, profit is allowed. In fact, a monopolist is meant to make profits. That is why the monopolist normally reduces quantity to actually maintain some level of price. Mind you, note, a monopoly can either control price or output, but the monopolist cannot control price and output at the same time. Instead, you control price, you allow the market to determine what they want to buy the output, or you bring your output and then the market now state the price. Now, for the equilibrium of the monopoly, profit is actually allowed. Now, for the monopolistic equilibrium, we have a situation whereby by the graph on my screen here, you can see the monopolistic equilibrium, where we have the demand curve sloping downwards, and then we have the marginal revenue curve, which is steeper than the demand curve, and then we have the marginal cost curve cutting across. Now, in a market, for a market to be at equilibrium, of course, based on the marginalistic rule, the marginal cost and the marginal revenue, they have to equate. That there must be an equilibrium between the marginal cost and the marginal revenue. And of course, from this graph, at point E, MC and MR equates. Now, we trace these points to the demand curve to get our PE, that is the equilibrium price, and our QE, that is the equilibrium quantity at point E. Now, the monopoly sells at PE and output at QE. Now, looking at the profit now. Just a minute. This is the cost. Now, from this graph, the profit of monopolies is giving us the area between PE and C, because C is assumed to be the cost, Y and QE is the output. Now, from the graph on the screen, the monopoly makes excess profit, that is the area between PE and C. Of course, like I said earlier on, the monopoly is out to make profits. All right, so from the diagram on the screen, the profit is given as the area between PE and C, of course, which is always there, because a monopoly is main aim is to actually make profit. Okay, now in short term condition, we have our marginal cost, our marginal revenue, our demand, our quantity, and our price. So this diagram just shows the monopolistic equilibrium, where profit is the region between PE and Q. Now, going further, let's now look at the price discrimination for monopolies. Now, of course, by definition, price discrimination occurs when a monopolist sells its products to different customers at different prices. Of course, we're saying that the monopoly not discriminate between customers, because as you don't sell this, as in the monopoly now have a discrimination on price it charges on the customer. A typical example is China. China imports a motorcycle to Nigeria, and they sell in Nigeria at a cheaper price, more than what they sell in the Chinese economy. That is a form of dumping the goods to in Nigerian economy, which discourages us from producing those goods. Of course, since they're selling it at a lower price here, for Nigerian indigenous company to produce, the price as in the price they will charge will be higher than that of the Chinese, and of course it discourages local production. Now, but let's look at it based on theory. Price discrimination occurs, like I said, when a monopoly sell a product, it's still the same product, but the different customers at different prices. We have the first degree, second degree, third degree, and the fourth degree price discrimination. But before we go into the degree, let's now look at the conditions that are necessary for price discrimination. Now, for the conditions for price discrimination, the first condition is that the market must be segmented. That means there must be separation in the market, either physical or artificial, but market must be segmented. That means the monopoly must be able to actually distinguish the market, to know the customers, to distinguish the classes or the categories of customers. That must be the first condition. Second condition is that the market must be barrier to avoid resale in the market. That means the monopoly must be able to now create a barrier. There must be a barrier either created by the monopoly or naturally there must be a barrier to avoid resale from one market to the other. The third point is that the price elasticity of demand, that the elasticity of demand in both markets must be different. That means consumers must react to the product differently. That means maybe perhaps a market might actually like that product more than the other market. And as an economist, if I'm a monopolist, maybe I'm market A, I'm market B. I'm market A, I'm market A cannot do without your product. They like your product. Why market B, maybe they can do without it. That means for market A that they really need the product, you can increase the price and then reduce that for market B. Now, these are the three conditions for price discrimination. One, I said, the market must be differentiated. Two, there must be a barrier to avoid resale. And three, the price elasticity of both markets must be different. Now, let's now go to the degrees of price discrimination. The first degree of price discrimination states that the monopolist charges its maximum price to the customers. For instance, you know, maybe you can sell this thing for maybe $20 or $50. As a monopoly, you pick the higher price, not the lower price, so that you can maximize your profits. The second degree states that the monopoly sell, the second degree of price discrimination states that the monopoly sell the same product to the same consumers but at different prices, such that any consumer that buys the same amount of quantity pays the same amount. In this case, the monopoly is discriminating on quantity. That is just like noodles now. Noodles, when you buy it in pack, in carton, you pay less than when you buy it in sachet, in pieces. So the same thing, in this case, maybe when you buy in bulk, you pay less than when you buy in individual units. So this is the second degree of price discrimination. Now the third degree of price discrimination is saying that the monopoly sell the same commodity to the same customers or in different markets and at different prices. Of course, now the monopoly is not then discriminating based on the market, whereby maybe market A price is higher than market B. And of course, for the monopolies to be able to do this, there must be barrier to prevent resale, because those in the cheap market can buy and then sell it in the high market. But to prevent this, there must be barrier so that people in both market cannot cross to either market. And the next one is the fourth degree. The fourth degree looks at the cost of the monopoly. This is saying that although the monopoly sell the price, it sell the product at the same price, but the cost of producing the product is the same. Sorry, I'm saying the monopoly sell the products at different prices rather, but the cost of producing the product is the same. Now, for instance, to produce a mobile phone now, maybe it costs $10. Now, assuming the monopoly now sell the phone maybe at home for $100, then abroad for $200. That means though this product costs the same amount, but you're selling it at different price. That's the fourth degree. Now let's look at the implication of price discrimination on welfare and output. Of course, with price discrimination, the monopoly can now sell it cannot sell more, it cannot produce more, because now since there are now more than one market, you can now take excess from one market and sell in the other market. That is, output can be increased with price discrimination. And again, since output is increased, welfare is also maximized, because since monopoly can increase its output, it also leads to increase in welfare on the part of the consumers. So price discrimination actually increases output and welfare. Now let's now look at common regulation of monopoly. Now, of course, monopoly is a very bad business. In fact, as an economist, if a consumer faced with a monopolist, you are liable to exploitation. Now, because monopoly is the only seller of that commodity and you can't do without that commodity, therefore the monopoly holds the key and the lock at the same time for that commodity. Now let's look at government and regulation on the monopoly. How the government regulates the monopoly? Of course, by tax. Government will tax the monopoly, and if they tax the monopoly, the incidence or the burden of the tax can be passed to the consumer, since it's the only seller, and this can lead to increase in prices. So when government tax monopoly, indirectly the consumer bears the burden, because the monopoly can really pass the tax to the consumer and in form of increase in prices. They add the tax to the production cost and the consumer bears the final incidence. The consumer bears the final incidence of the tax. Another way of government regulating is by price regulation. Government now actually regulate the price charged by the monopolist. It could be in case of price ceiling and price floor. Now, price floor is saying the government could charge the maximum price for the monopolies, saying that maybe this product should not go above this price, that is price ceiling. Now for price floor, the government could charge the minimum price for the monopolies, saying that this price or this product should not go below this price. Now, concluding this lecture, we've talked about monopoly, we talked about the definition, we talked about the causes, talked about the equilibrium condition, talked about price discrimination and economic regulation. Now, on the passing note, let me just give you some questions on monopoly. Of course, you could be asked, what are the causes of monopoly, or explain monopoly equilibrium. Thank you very much. We'll see you again same time next week.